As die mens oorlog verklaar, is het dikwijls die dieren wat in die kruisvuur beland. Gehok in dierentuine of vastgevang binnen die heinings van wildreservate. Hulle kan nie ontsnap as die skote eers begin klap nie. Hulle word doodgeskiet, gewond en vrek dikwijls van die honger. Een paar weke gelede het die Earth Organization van Weile Lawrence Anthony een optocht by die promenade in Durban gehou. Dit was deel van een bewusmakingsveldtocht vir een nieuwe VN-resolutie om wild in oorlogszones te beskerm.
So we're sort of at a precipice as mankind, and we have to make changes, and I think we have to be more ethical about everything we do to each other and to animals.
Nou, hierdie idee en concept het meer as 'n dekade gelede posgevat, toe die oorlede dierebewaarder Lawrence Anthony gedurende die Tweede Golfoorlog oor 'n oorlog geteisterde Irak gevlieg het. Sy missie? Om die diere wat in 'n verlate Baghdad dieretuin vastgekeer was, te red. In 'n 2009 onderhoud met die filmmaker Malik Benjulu praat Lawrence van die Baghdad dieretuin en sy ondervinding.
When the Iraqis invaded Kuwait, all the animals died in the zoo there. I was there. Some of them were machine gunned. The same thing happened in Kosovo. The same thing happened in Afghanistan.
En toe Amerika en die koalisie vroeg in 2003 oorlog teen Irak verklaar, het niemand aan die honderde diere in die Baghdad dieretuin gedink nie. Die grootste in die Midde-Ooste.
I just thought they're all going to die in their cages again. And I was actually here. And I said, well, I'll go. So I just went.
Toe hy daar aankom, was die oorlog al 10 dae in volle swang. Van die 630 diere was nog net 30 aan die lewe.
I mean, a battle had been fought through the zoo. There were the tracks of tanks running near the cages.
Hierdie foto wys waar 'n mortier in die leeukamp geland het. Net 'n paar van die groot roofdiere was oor. Die dier is deur 'n soldaat doodgeskiet. En die kleiner diere is deur plunderaars geëet.
When he put water into the lions' cages, they couldn't even drink. Their mouths had sort of gummed together, and he says they just immersed their faces in the water until actually the mouth became loosened up, and then they could finally lap up water. They were in shocking condition.
En dan was daar die diere wat net so gelos is om van die honger te vrek in Saddam Hussein en al sy meelopers se privaat dieretuine. Nou, Lawrence en sy span het klopjagte uitgevoer om diere wat uitgehonger en ontwater is te red, insluitend kamele, apies, bere en wolwe. En hierdie diere het in die Baghdad dieretuin geneem waar hulle gevoer en versorg was.
Was the Americans heard I was there, so they would contact troops, the Americans would contact us and say, we've got some lions for you here, or we've got some hyenas there, or we've got some ostriches in another part of the city.
Die diere is aan die lewe gehou met kos wat in die verlate paleise en hotelle gevind is. Van die Amerikaanse soldate het selfs al kospakkies geskenk om die diere te voer.
And that's how he got caught up in this almost 2-year zoo rescue effort that he did.
Die dieretuin en sy inwoners is vandag in 'n baie beter toestand. Maar met 15 bomontploffings, die dodelikste maand sedert 2008, is die diere voortdurend in gevaar. Al besoekers aan die Johannesburgse dieretuin mag tog nie bewus wees dat van hierdie inwoners eintlik oorlogvlugtelinge is nie. Burgerlike onrus kan net so dodelik vir diere wees as 'n volskaalse oorlog. Dominic Moss is die uitvoerende hoof van bewaring en navorsing by die Johannesburg dieretuin.
Unfortunately, it's a stark reality that some of the earliest casualties of any situation where you get any human conflict are the animals and the environment. And Luanda here is obviously one that came to us almost 20 years ago now, and that is as a result of, you know, civil unrest that was led to the demise of a zoo in Angola.
And what was his condition like when he arrived?
A lot of them hadn't had food, they were without some of the basic amenities, a lot of things like basic health care, veterinary care, and the welfare and such was jeopardized.
How do the effects of having survived a war manifest in animals? Do they get post-traumatic disorder?
Definitely. Animals suffer the same way we do. Whereas humans, it's almost easier because somebody can say, what is wrong? What are you feeling? But if you look at their behaviors, often it'll manifest itself with stereotypic behavior where they do the same thing. They pace up and down. or they'll just stop eating, or they'll just become a recluse, or they'll start aphagia, where they pull out their own hair, or birds will start, just plucking. They pluck all their feathers out.
As die getraumatiseerde diere eers hul gesondheid herwin het, is die volgende stap om hul gemoedstoestand te behandel. Een manier is om hulle omgewing te verryk.
We actually try and give the animals as much to do, keep their mind occupied, keep their mind off what they had gone through previously, and then we try and stop those negative or stereotypic behaviors.
Maar dis 'n opdraande pad.
Through the keepers, earn their trust, earn their respect, and then you start slowly trying to work with them until they trust you.
Dis makliker gesê as gedaan. Wanneer die diere wat jy moet rehabiliteer wild is en van die grootste soogdierspesies in die wêreld insluit. Die Tembe Olifantpark is in Maputo-land, teen die Mosambiek-grens. Dit bestaan uit rare sandwoud-habitat en huisves onder andere die skaam Suni-bokkies en sowat 220 olifante. Hulle staan as die Tembe Olifante bekend en was dekades lank aan die verwoestende burgeroorlog in Mosambiek blootgestel.
Baie diere is vermink, ander doodgemaak gedurende hierdie konflik met Mosambiek se teenkoloniale stryd in die 1960s en die burgeroorlog wat daarna gevolg het. Olifante het op landmyne getrap, sommige het hulle slurpe en strikke verloor en natuurlik die voorhandel het 'n beslisste rol gespeel in die finansiering van wapens.
Bruce Page is 'n ekoloog en 'n kenner op olifantgedrag.
Some of the bulls in the area used to have old bullet holes in them, difficult to see because a lot of them have grown over now. But if you look at one of those elephants, for instance, has a hole at the end of its trunk where it's obviously quartered in a snare, and that would have happened in Mozambique before the fences were up.
Die troepse weiveld was diere eeuwe in die gebied tussen Maputo-land en Mozambique, maar die beweging is ingepark na 'n heining in 89 opgerig is teen stroping.
It's not like the First World where people carry food around with them. In Africa, you shoot your own food, and generally soldiers are not particularly good hunters, so they just blast away with automatic rifles, and so the impact on wildlife is actually devastating.
Danksy die betreklike veiligheid wat die grensstraat bied, floreer die Tembe olifante en ander diere vir die afgelope 20 jaar in die gebied. Hulle is nie langer so onrustig soos voorheen nie, hoewel hierdie twee jong bulle nie baie gelukkig was toe ons te naby gekom het nie. Maar aan die ander kant van die grens is dit 'n ander storie.
But basically wildlife has been obliterated from southern Mozambique because of a war that went on for 14 years.
We just can't have that happen again. If we're going to cage wild animals, we need to take responsibility for them. We're asking for all wildlife in war zones, all zoos, veterinary hospitals, game reserves to be accorded the same status as schools and hospitals and be non-military targets.
Beide die diere en die omgewing sal beskerm word. Events uit die brandstigting van Irakse oliebronne tydens die oorlog is 'n goeie voorbeeld.
When the oil wells were set on fire, the damage to the environment was incredible and still is. The same thing in any war where habitat is burnt, where large tracts of water are destroyed, often poisoned in an effort as part of a war strategy.
Die resolusie dien tans voor die Verenigde Nasies.
There is quite a lengthy process that follows that submission. Because it is quite a large effect that we're trying to create and a large change we're trying to make, we now have to follow all the protocols.
Die volgende stap is om al die lidlande van die VN te ooreed om die resolusie te aanvaar. Die optog langs Durban se strandfront het geslaag om 'n bewustheid te kweek rondom hierdie kwessie. Steve Smith van die Monkey Helpline sê dit het net op die regte tyd gekom.
You have to only look at what's happening in Africa with the Somali conflict in the DRC to see what's happening to those populations of animals there, the primates in the west and desert animals in the east.
Rebelle troepe het berggorillas afgemaai en selfs van hulle gijselaar geneem in 'n poging om die regeringstroepe op 'n afstand te hou.
And I think it's not just the war as a declared war. There's a war on wildlife generally.
Die groot sametrek is 'n bewys van die steun wat die idee geniet.
We're part of the environmental society at our school, so we're quite nice to raise awareness for wildlife. So we studied Lawrence Anthony as well, so it was quite fun to do his work.
Here, if we don't care, what's going to be there for our children?
We have a lady, a professor in Boston, who's writing a white paper for us, and when that's finished, we'll publish it. And then it's also negotiations with the International Criminal Court.
Dis hier waar die wette geskryf gaan word, waar volgens mense vir oorlogsmisdade teen diere en die omgewing vervolg kan word.
No giving up. No giving up. This has to happen. It's not optional. Yeah.